Thank you. The main concern that most of us have is appropriate follow-up for the babies after they are discharged. There are many different options, and once the babies are discharged, we may have the newborn follow-up clinics done by your specialists or GPs. We may have general pediatric clinics they may go to, and it's very important to be familiar with the different aspects of newborn care. I'll have a quick summary of what we need to review. So first we should review the neonatal discharge summary. So before we come to that, we should make sure that our team in the newborn unit does a complete discharge summary which has all the necessary information. We should confirm that the newborn screening has been completed and the results should be chased if needed, depending on your setup, how the results come back to you. We should assess the present weight, the change from birth, review the jaundice, assess the feeding pattern, and if needed, offer the lactation support. The physical assessment should include jaundice. I mentioned the transcutaneous bilirubin, which is a very useful tool, and it may guide you whether we need to do serum bilirubin. The cord site is a major area of concern for parents, so always review and comment on that, because many times we have variations in that. If the nappy is covering the cord, sometimes it's smelly or sticky, so encourage them from the beginning to fold the nappy below it if there is any sign of infection or concerns. And later on, you may have to advise on umbilical granuloma or other concerns. Umbilical sepsis, thankfully, is very rare in our setup. The rashes are very common in the postnatal period. Be familiar with the normal rashes in newborn and advise the parents appropriately. Acne, for example, may start coming by 2 to 3 weeks of age, and that causes significant anxiety, so you can anticipate and inform them. If there are feeding issues, review issues like tongue tie, if it needs treatment or not, and latching, as I said, the lactation consultant review, and a general systemic examination as usual. The first case I'll discuss is a term baby who was born by normal vaginal delivery. The mother is primi gravida, and the baby was discharged on day 2 of life. The baby had a lactation consultant assessment as per the hospital practice. The baby was, it was mentioned that the baby needs additional support, though the mother was confident there was a difficult latch. Remember that this is quite normal in the first 2 to 3 days in a primary gravida mother. The mother is learning to feed the baby is learning to feed as well. So both are in the learning phase and they do need support. The birth weight was 2.9 kilos and the discharge weight was 2.7 kilos. The transcutaneous bilirubin was 8 milligrams, so there was no serum bilirubin done in this case because it was not high risk. The mother was very keen to breastfeed exclusively. However, she didn't have family support. She lived with her husband separately from other family. There was a follow-up arranged after 2 days. However, the husband had an emergency at work and could not keep the appointment. They came to the OP after 2 more days, by day 6. The baby was irritable, not keen on feeding. There was a reduced urine output. The baby felt warm, according to the mother. The weight now was 2.55 kilos, which has dropped 350 grams from the birth weight. It's approximately 12% weight loss, which is on the higher side of the acceptable normal. The transcutaneous bilirubin was high for the age, 18 milligrams, so it would need serum bilirubin. And because the sodium would be expected to be high with the weight loss of 12%, they requested the electrolytes as well as the bilirubin. The serum sodium was not too high, thankfully it was 151. And the renal function was within normal limits. The serum bilirubin was below the treatment level for that age. The baby was clinically well, apart from irritability, but was consolable as well. So these are good signs. Even though there was a significant weight loss, the baby had signs of dehydration, including feeling slightly warm, being irritable, and so on. It didn't reach a severe level of hypernatremia. How would you approach the management in this case? I will not wait for your answer because we are short of time. So the baby was given formula feed top-up and the mother was advised to continue working on improving breast milk. Remember that this phase was normal. So the mother struggled to achieve her lactation and that doesn't mean she cannot breastfeed. We should make sure that she understands that the key focus here is for her to work on increasing her milk output to a level that the baby needs. So encourage her to work on the right path. The baby does need additional milk at that stage. There is borderline hypernatremia. And the baby has weight loss. So we do need supplement for the baby. You don't need to admit this baby because the sodium is 151. The bilirubin does not need treatment. So the main focus when we converse with this mother is to reassure her that what she is going through is acceptable. We have to encourage her, we have to teach her the steps like expressing milk and teach her what she needs to look for to know that the milk output is adequate. The baby received breastfeeds, express milk and formula to ensure the baby received about 60 to 90 ml feed every 3 to 4 hours. The baby was reviewed in the clinic after 2 days. This is very important that you don't leave it for a long follow-up. We should ensure that there is nothing else wrong with the baby apart from inadequate intake. So the 2-day follow-up is key, and that's enough time for the baby to gain weight. Repeating the sodium is optional at this stage because it was not too high. Once you know the weight is increasing, the sodium is likely to come down. But if you feel you need to repeat, it's fine. Same with the bilirubin. Here the transcutaneous bilirubin reduced to 14, the weight gained 100 grams, and the baby was passing urine, was comfortable. And by this time, thankfully, with the lactation support and the expressing, the mother was starting to produce more milk. So she could easily wean off the formula milk. So this is the key part that you keep stressing on this, that you don't, if you need a formula supplement for any reason, make sure they continue the breast milk and work on increasing the output. Neonatal hypernatremia is a potentially lethal complication. More than lethal, it's a potentially brain-injuring complication. Cerebral edema, intracranial hemorrhage and seizures can happen. Baby may have excessive weight loss beyond 10 days of 10% birth weight, and it occurs in about 15% of exclusively breastfed babies. The clinical presentation may include jaundice, hyperthermia, reduced oral intake, reduced urine output, lethargy. These are non-specific, and in the severe cases you may have seizures, you may have the doughy feel of the skin if the sodium starts going high. And this is the range, you are familiar with that. If it is more than 160 to 170, it is severe and it would need very close monitoring when you reduce it. 155 plus, you may consider admission, but 155 and below, you can safely correct the dehydration in a phased manner and that should be all right. Most cases are related to lactation failure or delayed lactogenesis, you can call it failure. If you use the word failure, the mothers may be upset, they may be discouraged from producing more. So we can use the word delayed lactogenesis. The high breast milk sodium can explain in certain cases, but majority of the time it's a reduced volume. It's very important to be aware of what factors affect successful breastfeeding. So the adequate breast milk intake depends on several factors. The normal mammary development, which is given the norm in 99% of the mothers or more. So very rare to have an abnormal mammary development which affects lactation. There should be an unimpeded initiation of lactation. This is called lactogenesis, and the maintaining of the ongoing milk synthesis. So this depends on the prolactin and oxytocin and other factors, and the mother needs to be relaxed, she needs to be rested, she needs to get adequate support for this. In addition to the mother producing, it also depends on the baby removing the milk from the breast. This is milk removal, and obviously if the milk stays in the breast, it suppresses further production. This is the key part that we aim to support when we are expressing the milk. So even though the mother might have started producing the milk, if the baby is slow in learning how to feed, there will be difficulty in the further milk production and she may feel engorged. The milk may not increase as it should. And the baby is upset, and the engorged breast and upset baby leads to cracked nipple, pain, and this leads to a vicious cycle. So avoid this cycle by early intervention. The total daily milk intake depends on the frequency and duration of the feeds. In the beginning, we encourage her to feed 8 to 12 times a day, and later on, the baby adjusts to the need. The problems with feeding, the lactation support and education should be given right from the antenatal period, and in the first 2 to 3 days post-delivery, identify the high-risk mothers, the primary gravida mothers, the mothers delivering by cesarean, where the baby is small and has a difficulty in latching, where there is a tongue tie, so support these mothers more. So the average weight loss is 3% for the first 2 days. It's not hard and fast. Some babies lose weight more, especially if the mother received IV fluid in the first time before the delivery, and 2% for each subsequent day. Greater than 10% weight loss is a concern. More than 12% is significant, and we would suggest doing blood tests for that case. And sometimes we reach 10 to 12% by 3 to 4 days, and after that it starts stabilizing. So if everything works well, the baby appears to be gaining weight, you don't need to intervene. If 4 to 5% weight loss by 24 hours, start the lactation consultant review, identify it as a high risk. Review closely over the next 2 to 3 days to monitor the latch as well as the milk output, and consider using a breast pump. If the mother is working, you don't need to hesitate to make them buy a breast pump, because invariably when she starts going to work, she needs it. So it's not agreed, it's an investment of 800 dirhams or so, but it's not going to be wasted because she will continue to use it. And monitor the infant's urine output, sleep pattern, consider the serum sodium with bilirubin if the weight loss exceeds 12%. So careful follow-up is very important. It's likely to be helpful not only as a preventive measure, but also in early identification of vulnerable infants. All teams should remember that we should support the mothers through this period. This is the end of the first case. If we are running short of time, I can wind up in 5 minutes or so for the second case. So it's a bit long, but I'll make it shorter. 10 minutes? Okay, thank you. So the second case is a little more interesting than the first one. It was the first one. The aim was to focus on what we need to follow in the immediate period. So this is a term baby, and birth weight was 3.6 kilo, primary mother. It was a normal delivery with uncomplicated neonatal period. The mother was feeding exclusively with the breastfeeding. The baby had physiologic jaundice, no treatment. The discharge weight was 3.4 kilos, which was quite okay, and the TCB was 11 milligrams. The first follow-up was arranged at day 6. The weight at the first visit was 3.3. It was continuing to drop, but still it was within the normal range of weight loss, and the mother was confident that the baby was feeding well. The urine and stool pattern were normal. The bilirubin was stable. So you don't need to intervene in this case. You may just need a weight review after another couple of days. The newborn screening results was awaited, and the hearing screen was passed as well. The systemic examination was normal. The mother had started to express and top the bottle once a night as per the friend's advice. So many times this expressing milk helps her to balance her work life balance, or if she has other children, find some time for the other children as well. So if the parent chooses to do this, I don't discourage, but be careful that express milk by bottle works like formula feeding in that we are dictating the volume. So we have to teach them not to overfeed the baby. The baby was started on vitamin D drops, as is the usual practice, and the follow-up after 3 to 4 days to confirm the weight gain. We can also teach them a simple measure to monitor the weight gain at home. If they cannot come for follow-up, there is no need for this baby to review the jaundice immediately. So the parents can weigh themselves and hold the baby. So we can teach this technique, which all of us know. The parents don't know that. So teach them that so they can monitor the weight gain at home. On day 10, the weight gain was good. So 150 gram increase from 3.3 kilograms to 3.45. The bilirubin was reducing, so there is no need to worry about that. And the newborn screening results was normal. The mother started to give 2 to 3 bottle feeds of express milk, 60 ml or so. The baby was demanding more. Unfortunately, this is the time the colic starts, and also part of the reason this starts is the volume of milk is increasing. All the babies are physiologically lactase deficient, and they start increasing their lactase. The upgrading of the enzyme happens as they get exposed to the lactose in the milk. So it takes 3 weeks or so to reach that balance. In that period, if you start overfeeding the baby, giving the baby too much of a lactose load, the typical colic phase starts earlier. The baby starts getting a nappy rash. The baby is never satisfied. So it makes sense to stick with nature. Nature has designed the breast milk to come slowly, to increase slowly. But when we go for formula milk, we start giving too much milk. Or when we give express milk, we start giving too much milk. This may be one reason why multigravida mothers who have produced more milk, the babies have a nappy rash more severe in the first week, 10 days, because the volume of milk exceeds the lactose digesting ability of this milk. It's physiological. Reassure them. You don't need to change anything. Don't do stool tests. Don't do reducing sugar. Just tell her to slow down the pace of feeding. Don't keep feeding the baby. Occasional spit ups are there, which was reassured. The baby was feeding 1 to 2 hourly with above top of feed, which is a bit of an overfeeding pattern. I mean, if the mother interprets the baby's discomfort as a hunger and she keeps feeding, unfortunately the baby starts getting used to that pattern, but the baby gets more milk in the process. So you may see more reflux, more weight gain, more colic symptoms. They came to OP on day 19 with excess crying. So this is seen almost universally. The mother tried some over-the-counter drops with no improvement. The weight had gained quite a bit from 3.5 to 4.2 kilos, so nearly 800 gram in 9 days. The pediatrician suggested to avoid overfeeding and to space the feeds, but the baby has got used to a pattern. So it's very important to educate them from the beginning that space the feeds reasonably. Breastfeeding is demand feeding. There is no doubt that nature works. But the difference here is the mother's interpretation of the baby's hunger cues. She may be over-interpreting it. The baby had prolonged jaundice. The bilirubin continued to be 10 milligrams on the skin test. So I normally request a prolonged jaundice screen if it is close to 8 to 10 milligrams when they come for the 2 or 3 week follow-up. If you have done a bilirubin test in the beginning with a direct bilirubin, you are justified in waiting a little more, because the main concern is direct hyperbilirubinemia. And prolonged jaundice is when a significant level persists beyond 2 weeks in term babies and beyond 3 weeks in a premature baby. Majority are physiologic related to breastfeeding related jaundice or breast milk related jaundice. The workup, liver function and thyroid should be reviewed as well. If the newborn screen results are available, you review that. and it's important not to miss serious underlying causes. So this is just a list of conditions I'm not going to detail, but the main thing is to avoid missing the diagnosis of biliary atresia, and timing is important here, so don't delay. If you feel the baby is still jaundiced, it's much safer to do this blood test and rule out conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, so you'll be reassured. If the baby is not gaining weight or irritable at the same time, consider doing a urine analysis as well to rule out urinary tract infection. So day 27, the baby was refusing bottle feed, still gaining weight well, around 4.8 kilos, more frequent spit ups, but some signs of reflux were starting, like arching of the back, and baby was pushing away the bottle, was crying persistently. So the pediatrician rightly diagnosed reflux esophagitis. He stressed on that ways as before to avoid overfeeding. He gave a short course of 3 to 5 days of Nexium. This is very important that it's not evidence-based, but sometimes when the esophagitis sets in, the pain is because of the acidity, and to stop the crying, to break the cycle, you may need to use a short period, but don't overuse it. It's a dangerous drug in these age groups, because as we know, in premature babies, don't use it at all. In a big baby, if you're starting it, don't give a 2-week course, which most people recommend. Just stick for 3 to 5 days, the symptoms reduce. It's not going to do anything to the reflux. The steps you take to position the baby or to reduce the feeding frequency or volume will reduce the reflux. We don't want to use anti-motility drugs, but motility increasing drugs, I mean. But use this very shortly. Infant Gaviscon can help in these babies as well. You add the sachet to the milk if it is formula, and directly to the, before the feed if it's a breastfed baby. The mother suggested improvement, but then the symptoms continued. There was blood spotting in the stools. So then we came to a diagnosis of cow's milk protein intolerance. So this was a mainly breastfeeding baby. It can still happen because of the cow's milk antigen going through from the breast milk. Because of shortage of time, I'll go fast. The baby was, mother was advised to go off the cow's milk products, dairy products fully, including cheese, yogurt. You have to stress to them what to avoid. So ghee, cheese, yogurt, paneer, anything has to be avoided, which is a milk product. If the baby is on any formula feed, we have to go for a special formula, not the hypoallergenic formulas that we get here, but it should be either the extensively hydrolyzed milk or it should be the amino acid formula if you're giving a trial on formula. If affordability is an issue, you can go for the rice-based hydrolyzed rice formula as well. So the baby improved. Subsequently, she kept on avoiding the dairy products. When she started working and she needed some formula milk, she gave the one of the special formulas which I mentioned. By 9 months of age, the mother introduced some dairy in the form of yogurt, which the baby tolerated. Most of the milk allergies, the baby outgrows it by 6 to 9 months of age, and first the mother can start dairy in her milk when she is taking her own intake. And if the baby is still breastfeeding, that's a test as well. If the baby is weaned off, you can try introducing yogurt, for example, with the weaning foods. If the baby doesn't tolerate, it may take a week or 10 days to show the response. If the baby doesn't tolerate, you'd know that. So I'll not go through the theory now for shortage of time. So reflux, colic, as Dr. Nagib said, all these are on my YouTube channel as well. You can go back and review that there. So I'm sorry we are running out of time because we started late. So in breastfed babies, dietary protein avoidance for at least a 2-week trial is important. If the baby is very symptomatic, we could consider a period of extensively hydrolyzed or amino acid formula for the first few days of dairy protein if it's a severe symptom. Otherwise, you can wait for the few days and reassure her that the blood spotting may continue for another 4 to 5 days or so. It doesn't stop immediately because it's an inflammatory change in the gut. It's a mild enterocolitis, so it takes time to settle down. And again, when there is an accidental exposure, it may happen 7 to 10 days later as well, the symptoms coming back. So if any questions, I'd be happy to address in the end as well. Thank you.
Thank you.